This is Jeff. Yes, this is a very long video about how to skin a deer. There are plenty of other shorter videos that shortcut, no pun intended, that shortcut some of the process. I do not shortcut any of the process. I show you from beginning to end. And again, targeting those of you who are desiring to be able to do your own deer from the field to the table. Plenty of that in the introduction, so I won't get off into that. But just remember, I'm just another guy who loves to go hunting, loves to provide for his family. And so just a guy in his garage doing the best he can. So here you go. I noticed in my previous video about skinning and quartering that I missed part of the back strap and almost all of the hind quarter. And the reason is because I can't see what I got going up here, right? And I'm sure there's technological stuff where you could set up a little monitor somewhere and see what your GoPro is seeing. Frankly, in the technological world, I'm doing good just to get a GoPro strapped to the top of my head. So what I'm gonna do today is I'm gonna skin and quarter both of these does, and hopefully between the three, at some point of all three videos, capture everything that somebody would want to see who's just getting started in processing your own deer. So I will say I did. I believe I killed one of the spookiest whitetail does in all of the Texas Panhandle. This one right here. There was a group of four, two adult does, and then a yearling and maybe a fawn or two yearlings, I'm not sure which, but this one right here is, I'm telling you, scared of her own shadow. Scared of cattle, I chased the whole group maybe a mile and a half, mile and three quarters. I mean, really, really weird how spooky that doe right there was. Anyway, so what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna drop this one because I wanna get weights, field dress weights on both of these does. Do that for monitoring, kinda how the long-term health and size of the deer in the area. So, and we'll get ages on them. I probably won't record that, it's a little gruesome. Some of my shooting was a little gruesome. But anyway, so I'm gonna let this one down. I'm gonna take this one, I'm gonna skin that leg back so that I can get the hooks. It'll make sense later why I do that. I'm gonna get my scale from over there and I'm gonna hang that one up, get a weight, do all the skin and quarter on that one while this one's laying on the ground. Get that one done and then we'll hang the other one up, get a weight, and then we'll skin and quarter all that one. So that is the plan. And that is not very sharp. I don't know if you've got one, I don't know if you've seen these. I think I showed these last time. And pardon me while I attempt to get that a GoPro shot without taking the GoPro on and off my head. These are actually handy little tools. They're not, I wouldn't say they're not a foolproof little tool, but they're so daggum handy. And you see, you can do, it fits in my, I'm gonna have to hit them up for advertising space, but anyway, that fits in my pack, my little fanny pack. It doesn't take up any space, and yes, it does, it will make a sharp knife. The best, or my, not my best, but one of the most important thing is you have a flat spot right here to lay that on a table and just run it through that little runny through thing. I don't know what you call it, I'm sure it has a name. But it's okay. This right here is what's important, is once you do get it sharp, is to keep it sharp. And unfortunately, what you will notice while I'm, what you'll probably notice about me while I'm processing, is even regardless of the hundreds of these that I've done, I still have a hard time making myself quit and sharpen my knife. And that's what's important, is just, and it doesn't take long, you know, if you'll just stop every now and then, you know, during this whole process of just skinning, you should probably sharpen at least once, maybe twice. And then when you're doing the quartering, you need to do it several times. And what you'll probably notice is I probably won't do that. And then I'll also be struggling. You know, but whack. If you're trying to cut with a knife and you're going hack, having to reinsert hack, reinsert hack, reinsert hack, and you're sawing on stuff, you're wasting time and energy, but because your knife isn't sharp enough. And so if it's not, just stop and sharpen this stupid thing. It's worth it. Now a lot of guys have a hard time sharpening their knives, and we can do another video on that someday, not today. So what I do, I remove the skin back from about right here all the way back past the hock, and not cutting that tendon right there, because that's where I'm going to hang her from, and then I'll separate that back leg, and then I can hang her up higher, because then this leg isn't sticking up into my rafters and garage door stuff, see? And plus, also, then when it comes time to take that hind quarter off, I put the whole hind quarter in the ice chest. I don't take a saw, you don't have to saw it, it all comes off real easy. Now, usually I'll actually do this before I ever get the deer out of the pickup, but in this particular situation, by the time I had these two deer killed, field dressed, drug up to where I could get the pickup to them, I got home at about 8:30, which that's late for me. Ate supper, plus I'm kind of old, my back hurt, I got a bad hip, my hip was bad, and it was killing me, so I hung each up by one leg, make sure they were split open so they get some air. The temperature last night was 22 degrees, so that's plenty cool. One of the nice things about hunting does in January, it's always cool enough. Now, a lot of guys are going to cut that off. If this was a big ruddy buck, then I wouldn't be doing this way, but this is just the doe, and they got a little aroma on them, but it's not going to ruin anything. And this is really tough to cut through stuff here, too. And yes, I need to sharpen the tip of my knife a little bit. But if we'll just get all this started, this will make sense here in just a minute. You can tell by the way my knife is cutting. I'm sharp. I'm really good and sharp in a zone about right through here. And then I'm gradually getting duller out to the tip, because what you end up doing is you use that tip a lot more than you do the base of the knife. And you maybe shouldn't. Maybe I don't know what I'm doing. I've never had any formal training. If anybody has any ideas, if you're watching this and you go, gosh, man, you could be doing X, it would make that a lot easier on you, by all means, put some comments down there and let me know, because I by no means am sitting here claiming to be an expert. Now, I will say, okay, not expert, but I've done this a lot, just how I've made up to do it on my own. But what I would say is I may not be doing this the fastest way, the quickest way, or whatever, but the end result is my meat delicious? Can I feed it to people who claim they hate deer meat and convince them that deer meat is delicious? Yes, I can. And that is why I'm content with what I'm doing, but that doesn't mean I'm not open to new ideas and folks that have got more experience than me. Okay, so now that should, if I got that started proper, should just peel right back. Now, I usually, 99% of the time, I prefer to skin a doe as soon as I get home. Reason being, to me, what I've noticed, if it's cold and I'm, I don't want to say lazy, because last night I was literally physically hurting. But typically what I'll do is I will skin them as soon as I get home. And these I hung overnight because it was nice and cold and I was hurting. But to me, it makes it a little harder to skin the following day. So anyway, so what I'm doing here, there's a nice flat bone right here. I think I've covered this better in other videos, but I don't know what this looks like. So here's this flat spot of this leg. All right, so here's the hock. Here's what we're gonna hang it by right here. So we don't wanna cut through this tendon, because that's what we're gonna hang by. But what we're gonna do, this leg will actually separate nice and easy if you cut in exactly the right spot. You don't have to have a sawzall or anything like that. And so there's a nice flat spot here. And what you'll notice is these tendons right in here. These tendons, if you'll cut those, there's a, where this bone meets these carpals, there's tendons that hold all that together. And if you'll come up the flat spot and go just up on the ridge a little ways and then cut. Now we're gonna cut that tendon, but we're gonna cut it way down here. And I can feel it. There, now I'm in the groove. You gotta get it all the way around. There's tendons here also. If you'll cut it all the way around, then give it a 90 degree, give it some pressure. Oh, shouldn't be that hard. If you cut in the right spot, it should, there. If you cut in the right spot, it should just snap off like that. And it does have to be, I mean, literally right in the right spot. Millimeters can make a difference, okay? Okay, now she's ready to go. You know what, while we got this one hung up, let's see, I need that for the weight. I need that leg for the weight. Don't lose the leg. Every ounce counts, right? Let's go ahead and do this one too while she's hung up here nicely volunteering it. Easy access. Again, being very careful, I have to cut that tendon. If you cut that tendon, you can see I cut it open, but I didn't cut it in half, see? If you cut it in half, then she ain't got nothing to hang by. Phew, this one actually stinks a little. Well, now both these does had been bred. This is the second week of January. In the Texas Panhandle, our rut is typically middle of November, roughly speaking. Give or take, middle to late November. Seems like depending on the year. And both these does were bred with twins. I didn't bother to sex the fetuses, but sometimes I do. I've done it before and they were both bucks and then I felt bad about shooting the doe. I mean, the whole purpose behind killing doe is not just delicious meat, but also population control. And you do that by controlling the does because they're the ones who make babies, right? Shooting bucks does nothing to control population growth. Oops. All right, so same ball game we did before. Right up the flat part of this bone. Go just up on that ridge where you see those tendons. Give them a little cut. Have kind of maybe feel for that groove. Right there. Same on the back side. Kind of feel them give way. I can feel right in here that I can feel all the way down here that tendon slip when I cut it. So that should do, and you just give it a little bend like that, and then off it comes. Same thing, just from the other side, you know. Too deep. Now I'm creating a little bit of trouble for myself leaving that vein in there. And I know I am, but it's just, it's not worth worrying so much about. I know I tend to worry too much about stuff. Did that bad lightning. All right, remember, flat spot up on the tendon, cut right in that tendon, kind of let the knife hunt and find the groove. Feel the tendon slip down here where you're holding. Bend. Oh, must have missed. Yep, missed. I can't see what I'm doing. There we go. Okay. Now. Boy, it's a mess. I mean, it's just a messy thing to do it like this. It looks really bad. I mean, granted, my garage is also a disaster. I know that. In fact, if anybody's looking for a 1971 Super Beetle, holler at me. I might sell it, I don't know. Me and my daughter, several years ago, we bought that thing for $200 and sitting out in a pasture. Broke down for 6 years when we got it. And she thought it sounded like a little fun little car to drive. I thought it sounded like a good project for father-daughter project, and it was a lot of fun. We had a lot of fun working on that car together. Got it running, drove it around. In fact, it was funny, my wife wrecked her car and our other vehicle was in the shop, and for 3 days that 71 Beetle was our best car. All right, that all looks good. It's too late for that. So say since we're reduced the amount of slopping around, we do. I like to get rid of these ropes just so they're not flapping in my face all the time. All right, now we've got ourselves here. It's a 30-gallon. Plastic trash can from Walmart, which I have no idea how long I've had that. Long time. I'm not throwing away the legs. I gotta remind myself, don't throw away the legs. But I put a, I don't know, is it a 50? I don't think it's a 50. What does it say over there? 45. With a 45-gallon super tough trash bag, okay? So I'm not one of these guys who can go dump that carcass on a county road or out in a ranch or something with chronic wasting disease issues everywhere. That is totally freaking stupid for you to go dump a carcass. All you need is a big trash bag and a cheap plastic trash can from Walmart. Bag that up, tie it up. You can put it in your dumpster. It goes to a TCEQ, Texas Commission on Environmental Quality approved landfill, and all is good. Okay? So, let's... facing the wrong way for the light. Dang it. So if I turn around this way, I'm sure the exposure on the camera gets all that light and all you see is a silhouette of a deer. Well, too bad. If it don't work, it don't work. We'll do the other one the other way. All right, anyway. So all we're gonna do, we make preparatory cuts, see? So I'm gonna get it started, coming off, without cutting that tendon. You still don't wanna cut that tendon. Still gotta cut that all the way through. Oh, did you see all that hair? Oh my gosh. So I'm a hair freak. That is, I can't stand hair getting on my meat. And you'll notice, I'm gonna go through a lot of trouble to prevent that from happening. Including this little part right here. I try to get it started. Now, I'm trying to leave as much of this membrane-y stuff. Now right here, it's really not that big a deal right here at this point. But it's going to become a big deal when I come through this flank and then onto the shoulder. And the less of this tissues and tendons and stuff that you have attached, the better off you'll be. I'm just going to keep peeling that away from the meat. Keep peeling away from the meat. Peel away. Peel away. Little pieces so that you don't want this hair to flop back up there, you know. Okay. Now that should all stay down and not roll back up. See? Man, I hope you can see that. Okay. Now you notice there's a bunch of hair there. We're gonna come back around and address that here in a minute. Now, same routine here. Now you can see right there, there's dirt, sand, plants, and stuff where I drug these does. And we'll take care of it. Don't worry about that. Okay. A lot of these guys get all goofy about, oh, I don't field dress my deer till I get in. I'll get some dirty. It's no big deal. Okay, you're gonna rinse off a bunch of this anyway. If you don't, you're being silly because there ain't nobody can do this and not get hair all over it. Let me rephrase that. If you have a way to do this and not get hair, and what you'll see, I'm talking about this hair right here. You see? And that's not bad. I mean, I see guys that just get, I mean, coated all over it. And they'll say the same thing, oh, don't worry about it. You can't do it, not do anything about it. I mean, if you're going to get 10 hairs, if you're going to fuss about 10 hairs and get 10 hairs off, I don't guess it's any more or less work to get off 100 hairs. I don't know how much truth there is to that. Anyway, since we're not fresh, we have to go and get that started. And then once you get that started, it should peel like the other side did. And we don't want it slapping back up. Also, I didn't cut the udders off of these does due to the time constraints I was under yesterday evening. I need to get that tarp off of the way. Okay, same thing we did a while ago. Keep peeling that back away from the meat. 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 Get that far down and it won't snap back up. Now, you can see all that hair right there. Okay? Now, some of that I can just grab and pick off. But, here in just a second, as soon as we get this all the way down, we'll take a wet rag, a wet blue shop towel, and I'll show you something pretty cool. Let's make sure these guys are staying. Okay, so now, I'm gonna come all the way down here and get it started. I'm gonna come up there to below this knee on the foreleg. I'm gonna cut that off. I'm gonna start all the way down to the neck. And then I'm gonna go back up here. I'm gonna come all the way down. Same thing to the neck, round, cut that leg off. And you'll note, I'm not doing a whole lot of cutting and quote skinning, as you most see guys spend a lot of time with their knives cutting. So right here, there's this flank muscle. It's just a little, I'm not talking about this flank muscle. I'm talking about this little flappy guy out here, right? The one they wiggle when they want to shake flies off, right? If you'll start right up here and start getting that separated gently with your knife, you'll probably cut through the hide and don't worry about it unless you want to tan the hide, I guess. If you want to tan the hide, don't watch this video. I mean, don't watch it, but don't use this as your guide. But see how that's kind of rolling back? And so now when I peel that off, that should, usually, most of the time that will stay. And so what I try to do is to keep that rolling back all the way down. It gets a little tough when it gets down here along the sternum. This is some good meat right here. It makes good grindage. And by grindage, I'm just talking about just ground meat, you know? Not trying to make that hard. There's my tag, properly cut out. Now, so, well, I guess there's different ways to do this. All I've ever done is just, and this is what the part that's quite hard. Ooh, it's a lot harder on a deer's been hanging on that. Bend that up, And then we're going to cut right there through these tendons. And you'll feel it give. And just come all the way around into that soft spot. Connect your cut all the way around. Blow away loose hair. And put that at a 90 degree angle like that. And to give it a twist, which separates those carpals. And then all you gotta do is just cut that last tendon in this center that holds on. Okay, now we're gonna go up the inside of that leg and get that all connected. Connected meaning that is our cuts are all gonna come together. See, right up in there, I probably need a light. But, and then we're gonna try to keep that all on the deer. Pardon my sniffing, it's a little cold out here. It's about 34 degrees right now. Gotta get that started. Get these guys kind of started. It'll peel off here in a second, right off that knee. Comes off a lot easier if you come at it from the other way. This is always one of the more tricky spots because there's so much flappy meat and tissue that wants to try and hang on. Ooh. Little bloody pocket there. You see, I didn't cut very far when I was gotten there yesterday. Typically, I'll go all the way up under the chin. I was having issues. My knife wasn't as sharp as I wanted it to be. Speaking of. Cutting through that cutting around that foreleg along that joint on the front leg. Anytime you're cutting through a whole bunch of hair, you're dulling your knife unnecessarily. I could go underneath it, but frankly, there's certain time limits, not limits, but time constraints where I'm like, okay, whatever, just cut it. Stop and hit our knife a few licks. Back over here. I remember this is kind of like taking off a sock. Okay. Didn't have to explain that twice, did I? All right, now, same thing. Now, because I'm right-handed, do what I get to hanging up on something, not making that corner very well. So I'm gonna cut all the way through that hide. I'm gonna go ahead and go down the neck while I'm here. Turn me loose. All right, just gonna keep working that bang. Now, because I'm right-handed, and the way this all flows better, it's better once you get to this point to get back up here at the top. Now, I did not, like I said, I did not cut out the udder. So we'll go ahead and do that now, as well as take some of that dirt and hide and all that out of there. The udder just kind of attached to the skin as opposed it is to the inside of the body cavity. Remember that little flap of skin we were talking about? There's one over here too. Take me a second here to peel all this back. So this is where I take my knife and I cut up when I'm gutting and field dressing, I'll just cut these ribs at the cartilage where they attach to the sternum. So the side I already did was on the sternum side. And so this side is still over the sternum. And so there's a lot more here than there was on the other side. And so it takes a little more to get this one started. Just give it a good pull and then cut that tissue hanging on. We're gonna go back up to the top here in just a second. That little meat happens sometimes right there in that armpit. But you do want to get it separated like that. See how that's, I got a piece of meat there, but see how it's separated? Okay, now, oh man. Let's go back up here and see if we can't find that flap of muscle. Here it comes. Probably need to pull it down a little further. There he is. There he is right there. See him rolling back? Whoops. Like I said, if you're tan and hide, don't use this as your guide. Okay. Now that, I want to do, now we've got a whole bunch of pulling to do, a little bit of cutting. So what works good, if you start at the back, get the back skint down ahead. If we get the back skint down prior to pulling off the stuff in the front, pull off prior, get several inches further down the body, and then grab the belly side and catch up. It'll skin a lot easier and pull a lot smoother. Of course, again, letting them hang overnight comes with the consequence of being a little tougher to skin. Now, on the, sorry, I just started to say anything. One, get your freaking hand out of the way, okay? So I'm holding onto this tail down here. Well, that's, tail's just a bunch of joints, little bitty bones all jointed together. If you'll find a joint, kind of bend it, break it, put some pressure on it, and just kind of wiggle that knife around until it finds a cartilage. Hear it pop. And then bang, just like that, the tail will come right off. See? So that was just a little piece of cartilage in between those little bones. So pull that. Now we're kind of far enough. Go over and get caught up. Come over here and get caught up. Trying to do the same thing here, isn't he? It's better. 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 Okay, get it back first. And you see what I'm doing, grabbing that, sticking my knuckles in it, and rolling my fist down, pushing down. Now, see how that's all staying? Same way here, see? Can't do a lot about it on the back. Just kind of work with what you got. There's where I cut a hole in it. My apologies to taxidermists. Woo, she's cold. Now, had it been 70 degrees yesterday and like in the 50s or something tonight, I mean, this last night, I wouldn't have let this dough hang in the garage. I'd have sucked up however much I was hurting. And got her on ice. Feeling how cold she is what made me think of that. Now, usually, you get around the shoulders, you gotta do a little cutting. Like that, and it should peel about like that. Get you a little hole here. See? A little hole there. Kind of peel that down and away. See? Piece of cake. You for an old fart. Now, had you not kept all this on here, you'd be peeling all this, and then when it gets in here, it gets all kinds of tissue in it. You see what I'm saying? So, it seems silly, but the ease that we're having coming around the shoulder right now is all due to starting way up here to ensure that this stayed put, to ensure that this would stay put. Makes sense? We got a little bit hanging on here, but not bad. Just a little hole. I skinned him down for her. Yeah, I did. There's my hole right there. Just like the other side, I roll it away and down, away and down, away and down. And off it goes. Now, the neck always requires cutting. But you'll notice, we hadn't had the knife out since we were way up there. And if you do, if you do end up doing tendinitis or something, you'll be glad you did it this way. It's a lot less at the flesh, I think. I've actually heard taxidermist guys say don't do that. But I don't know. If you're a taxidermist, you're watching this. If you're a taxidermist, I can't imagine you're watching this. Other than you're watching like, oh my gosh, what is this guy doing? And I know, you know, I know guys that got like hydraulic or electric powered pulleys and stuff. They just hit that button. And apparently, I'm not gonna get anything out of that neck mate. Whew, I gotta take a little break. Now, one thing I do need this all for is cutting the head off. And it makes such a mess. I hit her a little further down the base of the neck than I wanted to, but that's about all she was gonna give me. Let's not forget to check her teeth. In fact, we should have checked. If you're the kind of guy that likes to check teeth, if you know what you're doing, don't be checking teeth if you don't know what you're doing, if you don't understand the tooth wear method. I mean, take it off and take pictures of it and send it to somebody who knows what they're doing if you don't know how old the deer is. And really, if I didn't have to, you know, if I was still at the ranch where I killed this deer, I wouldn't bother with this. But for disposal purposes, I gotta have somewhere to go. Really, I should go ahead and check her teeth. If you're gonna check teeth, you need a tool like this. Preferably, you pick it up, you wipe all the goo off your hands before you pick it up. Gosh, it doesn't matter. I mean, it's gooey nasty anyway, but. Anyway, jaw bar, that goes in the mouth. And then basically you use it to pry and hold their mouth open. And it works a lot better, especially on a deer that's been dead for 12 hours. It's best to do this. Actually, it's best to do it when they're as soon as they hit the ground to open their mouth up right quick and take a peek. I don't know why I didn't. Yeah, I was in a hurry. All right, darling, let's see what you got in there. I'll do that one. Fuck it, now, if I got it handy. They're awful young to be that spooky. See in there. She's just a 2-year-old. 78 pounds, that's pretty good for a 2-year-old. You're awful spooky for a 2-year-old. Don't mind my saying so there, darling. Let's put that down here on the ground. So, take note of that here on our little data sheet, 2.5. Apparently we had a great fawn crop back in 2018. All right, that's all I need from her. And again, usually I'll take neck meat off a doe. There's not a lot there, but you know, maybe 1 ground hamburger patty. 1.5 maybe. Not a lot, but given that I put a bullet right through the middle of all that, I don't think I'm gonna do it.